This series of lectures is about convective transport. In this video, we'll see about convective transport coefficient and its relation to boundary layers. First, let's recall boundary layers. Boundary layer is a flow near a solid surface. Very close to the wall, you have no slip boundary condition and the velocity of the fluid is zero. Far away, the velocity assumes the free stream velocity. In this case, it is u naught. Because the velocity is zero here, the packets tend to retard the layers of fluid above it. Similarly, this packet tends to retard the fluid above it and so on. So this deceleration of motion leads to a gradient in the velocity. And this propagates from down upwards. We define velocity boundary layer as the distance at which, at the perpendicular distance from the surface, at which the velocity of the boundary layer reaches the free stream velocity. So beyond this, the velocity is equal to the free stream velocity. And between this and this value here, is the boundary layer thickness. For most engineering applications, the boundary layer thickness is taken to be 99% of the free stream velocity. So when velocity reaches 99% of the free stream velocity, that distance is considered to be the boundary layer thickness. This is for the velocity boundary layer. We could also have a thermal boundary layer, in which case, we have a fluid entering at temperature T naught and which is uniform throughout, but the plate is maintained at a temperature TS, or the surface temperature is at TS. Let us say TS is greater than T naught. Then very close to the surface, the temperature of the fluid will be equal to TS. Similarly, very far, it will be equal to T naught. So the distance, so there will be a drop in temperature by conduction from TS to T naught. So similar to the velocity boundary layer, the thermal boundary layer thickness, that is this distance, is defined as a distance at which the difference in temperature is 99% of the maximum temperature difference that can occur, which is TS minus T naught. Let us see the relation between conduction and convective transport coefficient. Consider a flow with a temperature T infinity past a flat plate, which is at TS. So we have a thermal boundary layer going from TS to T infinity. Now, very close to the surface, the packets of fluid are all stationary because of the no slip condition. And just above, you have the moving layer, which is again decelerated by this, which moves at a small velocity. This is zero and this is small velocity. And then very far away, you have the free stream velocity. Now, because this layer is stationary, the only way heat can transport from this solid surface to this fluid surface is through conduction. Again, think of a molecular picture here. There is no vertical velocity here that can take heat from the surface up to this. So in actual, the layer very close to the surface of this, very close to the solid surface, it is actually conductive transport. This part, these velocities are all zero here. The only way heat can transport from here to here is by random motion. And random motion is a diffusive motion, and that is a conductive motion, and that is not convective motion. So the total heat transfer, local heat transfer from the solid to the fluid can be written as Kf times partial T by partial Y, where Kf is the conductivity of the fluid. So if there is a temperature gradient here, the temperature gradient at y equal to zero in the fluid, not the solid, the temperature gradient in the fluid at y equal to zero times the conductivity of the fluid, note its conductivity of the fluid, is the heat transported from solid to the fluid. At steady state, the heat flux from inside the solid equal to the heat flux in the fluid. So heat flux in the fluid is Kf times partial T by partial Y at Y equal to zero. This is the local heat transport. Now, most problems that we have solved now, we have used the Newton's law of cooling for accounting for convective transport, which is Qs double prime is H times Ts minus T infinity. This is Ts minus T infinity. H was defined as the convective heat transport coefficient, which is a convenient way to express the rate of heat loss. But what is it, this convective heat transfer coefficient? It can be defined now by this expression. So equating these both, we have H is Kf times partial T by partial Y divided by Ts minus T infinity. So far, we have been taking H as given. But how do we actually find H? We find H by this expression. If we are able to solve for the temperature profile, then we can find partial T by partial Y at Y equal to zero. So from the temperature profile, we find the derivative at the surface and then multiply it by Kf by Ts minus T infinity, you get the heat transport coefficient. The main objective of studying convective transport is to actually determine this expression for H. One way for simple flows is to actually solve for the temperature profile. If temperature profile is not solvable, we can come up with other empirical methods to determine the temperature profile and hence the convective heat transport coefficient. There is a similarity between heat transfer, thermal boundary layer and mass transfer boundary layer. Consider a fluid which is entering at a concentration of a species A. There's a mixture of A and B. B is the solvent and A is a dilute species. And there is this plate here, and this plate is porous. So in the plate, below the plate, we are able to maintain the concentration of A at CAS. Let's say this is a bulk fluid and we are able to maintain here at CAS. Whereas what is entering is at CA infinity. Therefore, we'll have a concentration gradient from CAS to CA infinity. This is exactly same as the temperature gradient that we saw in the temperature thermal boundary layer. So the expressions are also very similar. The diffusive flux of species A from the solid to the fluid is given by DAB, which is the diffusivity of A in B, partial CA by partial Y. Again, why is it purely diffusion? Because the surface which is close, the layer of fluid which is close to the surface is at zero velocity. And the only way molecules from the inside the surface can go through the surface to the fluid is by diffusion. So although an entire transport is called as a convective transport, very close to the surface, it is diffusive behavior or conductive behavior in the case of thermal boundary layer. Similar to the heat transfer coefficient, we can also define a mass transfer coefficient. In this textbook, it's denoted as HM. In mass transfer courses, when you come across, it will be written as KL or a different way. All right. So we have this total flux given by the mass transfer coefficient times CAS minus CA infinity. Again, this mass transfer coefficient can be estimated by this definition by equating these both. We get mass transfer coefficient is defined as DAB partial CA by partial Y at Y equal to 0 by CAS minus CA infinity. Again, the way to determine mass transfer coefficient is to solve for this concentration profile, take its derivative at Y equal to 0, and then substitute in this expression. What we have studied so far is called as the local transport coefficient. Why is it local? Because the way it was defined, H is partial T by partial Y at Y equal to 0 at the given location X. Now we know that the boundary layer thickness varies along the length. Because the boundary layer varies along the length, the local temperature gradient also varies along the length. And therefore, this H that we define is the local heat transfer coefficient at this location. In the macroscopic problems that we solved earlier, we used a single value of heat transfer coefficient, 100, 200, 50, and so on. How do we get that if it is going to be a function of the distance along the surface? To do that, we look at average heat transfer coefficient. Average heat transfer coefficient is defined for the total heat transported. So when we solve macroscopic problems, we look at the total heat that is transported from the surface to the liquid by convection. And the total heat transfer, convective heat transfer coefficient is defined for the total heat flux, that is Q, integrated over the area, Q double prime integrated over the area, which gives the total heat rate. Again, substituting for Q double prime as H delta T, integrating this would give you the total heat. Now, this total heat rate is defined in terms of HA delta T, where H bar is now your average heat transfer coefficient instead of a local heat transfer coefficient. And again, equating this to this, we find that H bar is nothing but an average value of H integrated over the entire surface. For macroscopic problems, we'll be using H bar. How to get H bar? We get H bar by taking an average of all the H. How to get H? From this expression, if we solve for the temperature profile, we can find the derivative, find H, and then integrate it over the entire area, find H bar. Let us now see the relationship between heat transfer coefficient and the nature of flow, which could be laminar or turbulent. Laminar or streamline flow occurs in the leading edge of the boundary layer flow. So if you consider a flat plate and the flow is entering here, the initial regions of the boundary layer is streamlined. But as you go along this distance, we'll notice that at very large distances, the flow can become turbulent. You might have heard of Reynolds number. Now this Reynolds number is slightly different in that it is a dimensional distance x. Instead of du rho by mu, there is no diameter in the flat plate. It is just a flat plate. So we can, the length scale is taken as the distance x from the leading edge. So when this dimensionless distance x rho u by mu, which is Rex, denoted as Rex, becomes much greater than 1, that is, you go farther and farther down this distance, then the flow can become, Reynolds number can become very large, and then the flow can become turbulent. In the turbulent region, we usually define three convenient regions of the flow. One, which is very close to the surface, is called as a viscous sublayer. Viscous sublayer, the flow is laminar or streamlined, but that is very, very close to the surface. And then very far away, you have the turbulent region where the transport is through convective mixing. So each of all the fluid packets move randomly here, but there is a mean motion. Here, there is no random motion. There is only a streamlined motion. In the viscous sublayer, the transport is through diffusive transport, which is either conduction or diffusion of momentum or heat. In this region, it is turbulent mixing. And there is an intermediate region where both are of equal magnitude. That is the convective mix, the diffusive mixing and the turbulent mixing are of equal magnitude. That is called as the buffer region. How does the convective heat transport coefficient depend on the nature of flow? In the turbulent region, we can identify two boundary layers. One, which is the actual boundary layer, which is the distance from here to here, where the flow is turbulent. And beyond this, again, the flow is streamlined because the flow that is approaching there from here is all streamlined flow. It's a free stream flow, streamlined. So the distance from here to here, till which the flow is turbulent, is the total or the actual boundary layer. But there is an effective boundary layer. The effective boundary layer comes about because the flow here is mixing turbulently, and because of that, the velocity variations here is again flat. If you notice here, we said that 99%, the velocity reaches 99% of the free stream velocity, that is the boundary layer. If you use the same definition, the effective boundary layer here would be somewhere very small at this distance. So at this distance, the flow reaches 99%, the velocity, the mean velocity reaches 99% of the free stream velocity. And therefore the effective boundary layer is actually very small, smaller than your laminar boundary layer, which was high at that location. If you recall, the definition of heat transport coefficient was Kf times partial T by partial Y by Ts minus T infinity. Now, if we can approximate T partial T by partial Y as delta T, which is Ts minus T infinity, that is this delta T, divided by partial Y delta Y, which is the boundary layer thickness. So the temperature goes from Ts to T infinity across this boundary layer, right? So H, convective heat transport coefficient, is scales roughly as fluid conductivity divided by the thermal boundary layer thickness. So as delta T increases, H decreases. So in the laminar region, we can see this is the sketch of delta, and this is the sketch of H. As delta increases in the laminar region, H decreases as expected through this. But after a transition region where there is sometimes turbulent, sometimes laminar, beyond that there is turbulent. In the turbulent region, you see a sudden jump. The boundary layer actually gradually increases with small jump here. However, the heat transfer coefficient is not here. It does not continue down below here, but it jumps to a very high value and then comes. That is because the effective boundary layer has gotten smaller. Since the effective boundary layer has gotten smaller than the laminar value, the actual boundary layers here, the effective boundary layer will be somewhere here. Because of this has gotten smaller, you see a jump in the heat transfer coefficient. And after that, again, as the boundary layer keeps on growing, the heat transfer coefficient becomes smaller and smaller. Notice that the heat transfer coefficient for the turbulent flow is much higher than that for the laminar flow. And this is very useful in generating a very good heat transport from the surface. To summarize, we studied about convective heat transport coefficient, and it is important to understand that boundary layer is key to convective transport. The convective transport coefficient actually accounts for the temperature drop across this boundary layer. That's why it's important to understand boundary layer for convective transport coefficients. Convective transport coefficients have local and average values, which are obtained from the temperature gradient across the surface. And in turbulent flow, the boundary layer, a turbulent boundary layer, has got a higher convective heat transport coefficient than the laminar boundary layer. Thank you.